Good morning, everyone. We shall continue with the derivation of the Maxwell's equations in not anymore into vacuum, as we did at the beginning of the lectures, but we are going to introduce a medium, as we have seen in the past lectures, where now we have basically the fact that an incoming incoming electromagnetic wave is going through a plasma, and the charged particles of the plasma are going to react. Right? There is the Lorentz force working upon them, and they need to move somehow. Okay? Therefore, it is a motion of the particles that creates also a displacement, as we have seen when we studied the presence of a test particle into our plasma. We have seen if we have a positive charge, the positive charges in the plasma are going to be kind of pushed a bit away because of the Coulomb interaction. The negative ones are going to be attracted, again, because of the Coulomb interaction, and this creates a local net charge. Okay? This electromagnetic, this field that is created in this way must be included into the field of the incoming electromagnetic wave. And altogether, since the total solution, as we've seen because of the superposition principle, is the sum of all the solutions, meaning the potential, I mean the fields given by the charges and the one of the incoming electromagnetic wave, when we look at this field, we see, at the total field, we see an electromagnetic wave which is different with respect to the incoming one. Okay? Therefore, from that, from this very simple consideration, we understand that electromagnetic waves, when traveling through a plasma, are affected. They change, the properties are changed, are affected. Okay? They can change direction, for instance, or frequency. Good. So what we've seen, basically, as I said, we had the interaction between the particles and the field, and the things goes in two directions because the field is affecting the particles move, and the field back react on the, the particles back reaction, through back reaction reflect, basically affect the field itself. Therefore, there is this interplay between the two components. And what we want to do now is to derive the Maxwell's equations. And since we are dealing with a linear theory, as I said last time, we want to stick to a linear theory, and therefore the electric field that we might have is affected in a linear way by epsilon. And we call this the electric tensor. And as we've seen, this is a tensor because we might have privileged directions within our plasma, and to account for this sort of anisotropies, we need to have a tensor such that we can deal with this linear combination of this vector, now a matrix, something that has a matrix form, such that the displacement field D can have a different direction with respect to the initial electric field. Okay, therefore we've seen that epsilon must be a tensor. Moreover, since the plasma can be non-homogeneous, as well as non-isotropic, but non-homogeneous, we might have a dependency of epsilon with respect to position, and if the plasma is moving, somehow it's changing the density locally, we might have also a time evolution. So epsilon depends on the properties of the plasma. Then we will dig in into the plasma properties to see what is epsilon should be given certain condition of the plasma, that the plasma have. The same goes for the magnetic field. Again, we have a tensor that accounts for the presence for the fact that we have a plasma, and still we stick to a linear theory. Okay? What we did then is to assume that the magnetic momentum of the particles is equal to zero. I remind you that the magnetic momentum is defined as the torque given by a magnetic field. So this expresses the effect of a magnetic field on our particle that we assume to be zero. Okay? Therefore, the magnetic field is not a presence of a magnetic field of an external electromagnetic wave is not affecting the particles. Therefore, we can set mu equal to zero. Mu equal to one. H is equal to B. Now we start to enter into our plasma to see how we can express this epsilon and understanding our D, our displacement auxiliary field D. And we have to think in terms of the fact that we have a local area of our plasma, and what we can do is to think as this little area, so the electric field that is composed by this little area, as composed by the superposition of electric dipoles. Okay? We can then perform an expansion. We have the monopole term, the dipole term, the quadrupole term, the hexapole, blah blah blah, and so on. All these terms for the expansion of this dipole, and we just keep the dipole. Okay, so just the leading term. Then what we can think of is that this little dipoles that are locally associated to our particles what we care about is the superposition of their contribution. Okay? Therefore, we can define the polarization, a macroscopic polarization that incorporates the sum of all of these contributions. Okay, so just give you a drawing. So we can imagine these electric dipoles. We want always to consider ensemble properties over some small volumes, larger than the BA length, as we have seen. And the ensemble superposition of all these dielectric, dielectric components is this macroscopic quantity that we call polarization. So how can we better express these terms and associate it to an actual overdensity of charges? So we can then construct our polarization associated to these charges as rho pole. It's equal to minus the gradient of this polarization. So this is how this macroscopic polarization is defined. Okay? The minus is for convenience, as we will see later. And you see that we define the density, such as the gradient applied to this vector, is actually the polarization. Okay? So that's how we construct it. What is the meaning of that? Now I just give you a few dimensional considerations. So look, this is a concept, this is not a, I want to show what is the physical meaning of this. So this is a charge density. So if we forget about the fact that this is a charge over a volume, this is Q. This is basically referring to the charge that is given by this volume, okay? Then what we have? We have a gradient, which is what? A derivative with respect to a position. Let's take the x. Then we have this polarization, but we want to have something which is a charge. So what do we have? The integral of the charge in the x. Okay? So you see, if we make the derivative with respect to the position of the integral of a function over a position, we get Q. So look what we have. This is our gradient, and this is our macroscopic polarization. Okay, so that's the concept that helps us to define this object with this gradient. And now we will see why this gradient is very convenient in deriving the Maxwell's equations. But first of all, if we have now this displacement of charges that is creating this charge polarization, we can also, this guy can also be associated to a current, right? And this rho pole, this polarization, this density, must be conserved. Like charge conservation must apply also to this density. Charge conservation that is expressed by the continuity equation. Therefore, what we're going to have is that the time variation of our rho pole plus the gradient of rho pole V is equal to zero. Now I can plug in our definition of our charge density associated with this polarization, and we can find out what is the relationship of the current to the current that is associated to this polarization, because we know that this is J pole. Okay? So we have delta T of rho polarization plus the gradient of the current associated to this polarization must be equal to zero. For we plug in our definition of rho, you see that we have a gradient, because this is the minus the gradient of our big P. We have a gradient, we can group the two gradients together. And what we get is minus, because there is the minus here. Then we have the polarization P plus J pole is equal to zero. This must be true for all polarizations, and therefore this guy must be equal to zero. And this gives us our J pole, sorry, this is a vector as well, is equal to the P over the. Ah, and I forgot the operator dt. Yeah, of course. Dt minus. And we have our key players. You have this macroscopic representation of the charge density and the current, which is associated to the displacement of the particles in the plasma. Now we can move on. Now that we have the density, the charge density polarization, we can now modify the original Maxwell's equation. So we can take Gauss' law, and we have that the gradient of the electric field is equal to 4 pi the charge density that we now have to which this is the charge density of our plasma, we must now include this additional component. We now plug in again our definition of the polarization. We have a gradient, so I can bring this term together such that I can apply the gradient to the electric field plus the gradient of minus polarization. So the minus that will go here becomes a plus on this side. And then we have the 4 pi and then the polarization equal to what is left, which is 4 pi rho. And now we define this guy. We can identify this guy with the auxiliary term, the auxiliary field D. That's about the electric field. Now let's give a look at the magnetic field, how it's going to be affected. And for that, we use Ampere's law. Which we know that the curl of the magnetic field B is equal to 1 over C, the time variation of the electric field, plus 4 pi over C times the current. So the current, J, is the source of the magnetic field, J, plus this current induced by our polarization. Once more, we know what the current is, what is the association of the current to the polarization P. We just plug in here our definition. We have gradient and gradient, okay? And if we now put together this component with J, we basically get that this is equal to 1 over C d over dt plus 4 pi over C j. So you see it's very simple. We start just with for example, here with Gauss' law, we include the polarization. We use the definition of the relationship between the charge density and the gradient of the polarization, and we obtain our displacement field. Then we work out what is the modification of Ampere's law that is given by the fact that we have to include now the charge current given by the polarization, and give us this expression. Now, for simplicity, we are going to assume, and for simplicity also because it's a very common case, actually it's the most common case in astrophysics, the plasma is globally neutral, okay? In fact, usually if you have a plasma, say a nebula, usually you have an ionization process, so you have an atom which is losing an electron. This guy is going to gain a charge positive plus one, the free electron is minus one. Globally, this is happening for all or most of the atoms, and globally we have our plasma to be neutral. And then I remind you the assumptions that we did before, that the magnetic moment associated with the particle is equal to zero. So now we further assume that. And if we do that, from Gauss' law, you see the density is equal to zero. Therefore, we have the D is equal to zero. Then the gradient of the magnetic field is not affected because of that. Then our Ampere's law, for which we have the time variation of the electric field, that is the dot here, plus 4 pi j, so I brought these terms together with this, is equal to C gradient, the curl of the magnetic field. Then the time variation of the magnetic field is not affected because there is no polarization taking place there. So it is our Maxwell's equation in presence of referring to the presence of a plasma. And I remind you that also the fact that we can associate the current J to the conductivity rho. That's the definition of the conductivity. Okay? Conductivity. And these four are our four Maxwell's equations. You see, it is everything very simple. The key point here is that the modification of the charge distribution is captured by this macroscopic polarization P. Okay? Superposition of dipoles, electric dipoles, that are expressed by that gradient. You see? And the superposition, you see how it's come about, because we have in our sketch, in the yellow box, you see that is an integral of the charges. So this is an integral, the superposition of all the local electric dipoles. Okay? So the physics is basically everything there. The rest is just say, okay, now I have Gauss and Ampere's law, I introduce this new charge density, which is associated to the polarization, and this new charge current, which again is given by the very same polarization. And the density, the charge current, was derived by the fact that also the polarization, the density, the charge polarization, must obey charge conservation. Okay? So the physics is there. Macroscopic polarization, superposition of dipoles, and continuity equation, conservation of charges. The rest follows. Good. So now let's dig in into the dielectric tensor. And let's see how this is connected to the polarization. So D, I remind you, the displacement charge, the displacement field is given by that. So this guy must be related to the polarization. Let's find out. So here we're starting to dig in into the nature of this epsilon and associated to the to the particles that are constituting the plasma. Okay. Now, where is this D coming from? Well, remember that, as I said, since epsilon is associated to some position in time, same is for the electric field. So this must be the case for the displacement field D. That's a T. But this is given by the superposition of all the electric charges that you have around. Again, this is a schematic. You have your electric fields for some other position and time that is associated to that. Because if you have the position x, you have all the things that are happening around. You have different times for different parts that are affecting the electric field. So if we have an electric field here, we know that it's propagating with the speed of light, is going to in vacuum, is arriving at this position. Something that is further away is might have a different electric field and it arrives with a different time. Therefore, all of these different electric components are going to be resulting into the final displacement field at the position x, at the time t. So these primes stand for the fact that all different locations, that the electric field here is given by the superposition of those the electric positions that are coming from different locations. Therefore, we have a superposition of these electric fields, and we can therefore express the D in terms of a convolution. Because the convolution, you know, is the integral of the functions time at a kernel. Okay? Being this integral, this gives you the expression for a superposition. And we know that in a Fourier space, convolutions are very conveniently expressed in terms of a product. Between the kernel and the function that is convolved. For our Fourier transform of the dielectric field, now I take one component, E, remember that it is a vector. In the Fourier space, it is not expressed anymore in terms of times, but in terms of frequency. At the position k, the same goes for the position. We are not using anymore the position x, but the modes k. It's equal to the dielectric tensor, which is the function that is providing the convolution, meaning gives you how the different electric fields in different locations are summed up in a weighted way to give you this final term. Again, this is a function of omega and k times the electric field that is summing up from all locations. Okay? So in Fourier space, you see Fourier transform to Fourier transform, a convolution of the dielectric tensor and dielectric field is expressed in terms of a product. Now that we have that, we can use an ansatz to see how we can more explicitly express this dielectric tensor epsilon. And we have that epsilon, the Fourier transform of epsilon tensor, therefore ij, we have the two indices, omega k is equal to sum scalar epsilon A Fourier transformed delta ij plus ki kj with this let's use another symbol like this B Fourier transformed, which is the other coefficient here. Okay? So what is this tilde? Well, this tilde is just if I take the component E, if I take the overall, it's equal to K over the modulus of K. Okay? So one piece at a time. So that's our ansatz. What does it mean? We have this part. You see we have a Kronecker delta, which is a matrix. 3 by 3, which is 1 along the diagonal and 0 on all other places. Therefore, this is a diagonal matrix which all components are equal to A. If we now multiply this epsilon with the electric field, this is not going to change the direction because all off diagonal terms are equal to 0. Therefore, this guy is only going to amplify or make the electric field smaller, but without changing the direction. Whereas these other terms, you see that we have a ki kj, this is going to affect the direction of our vector. And you see that there is this tilde because we normalize this vector such that it's unity. So one term takes care about how this guy is going to be magnified and how the electric field is going to change direction. Okay, that's the meaning of this guy. We can also, as well, re-express the electric field in terms of a decomposition. In which we have, now I drop the omega k, so whenever you see this, this at, you know that this is referring to omega k. It's a function of omega k. So we can decompose it in a component which is parallel to the vector k, and another component which is orthogonal to the vector k, where these two guys are projectors. Okay? So these guys, if you have a pi parallel, okay, ij, whenever you apply to the vector kj, gives you the component ke. Whereas if you have another, so let's make it more graphical, then I give you the mathematics. Let's go. If we define, for example, a vector k that is pointing in this direction, here you have the mixture. If you express the epsilon in terms of this decomposition, you get the component epsilon, which maybe is a vector, so this is k, this is epsilon. You express this, the epsilon parallel is going to be the component parallel to k, so it's going to be this guy here. If you use this projector, you obtain this other component here. Okay? And the sum of the two gives you your epsilon. Now, what is k? Well, if you have an, a completely isotropic plasma, the only thing that is giving you a direction, a reference, might be an incoming electromagnetic wave. Therefore, if we have an incoming electromagnetic wave, we know that its direction of propagation is is characterized by a certain vector k, which is going to give us this definition. Therefore, whenever I'm going to use this decomposition into projection, you can imagine your plasma, you have an incoming electromagnetic wave, and we make the decomposition of epsilon into the component along the propagation of the electromagnetic wave and orthogonal to the direction of propagation of the electromagnetic wave. Now, since this, no, I don't want to go through it. And the propagations are pi I j parallel equal to k I k j, and the one orthogonal p I j is equal to delta I j minus p parallel I j. I just give you the expression for one. So why they look like this now? This looks kind of obscure, this projector. I wanted to make super clear what is their meaning, and I think I did, okay? So remember that we made the decomposition of a vector along k and orthogonal to k. Now, why they look like this? Well, let's give a look. We start by looking at just making a simple consideration by the fact that k tilde component I multiplied by the vector k is equal to what? Well, we just use the definition, which is coming from up there. So this is going to be k I over the modulus of k times k e, scalar product. that's equal to k squared over k, which is equal to k. Okay, so this is equal to k. This will be convenient later, okay? Then if we look for kij, ekj, tilde, tilde, what is it doing? What's happening whenever we apply it to another vector? So you see, this is the scalar product, jj, okay? So I am projecting this vector over this other vector here. Okay, for a fixed E, I keep fixed E, and I'm making the scalar product. Well, what we can do? Well, look, we know what's happening here. This is equal to K. Here I wrote E and E, this is J and J, but these are dummy indices. I can as well call this guy J and J. Look, let's do it. J, J, J. J is equal to K. Therefore, this is equal to KE tilde times K. But what is the definition of K tilde? Well, it's up there. It's actually K, the vector, divided K, multiplied now with K, this drops. Therefore, you see, that's component E. Therefore, this is E, component E. Therefore, you see that whenever we have this guy and we make the scalar product between this object and a vector, we obtain the ith component that is given by this E. Okay? This sets the direction over which we are computing the component of the vector. Therefore, this guy here is our projector parallel IJ. Okay, now you understand why this guy looked like that. Then, if we want to understand why this is defined in this way, we can just take what is left. You see, we have ij, we can think of it as a matrix. What we can do is, since we want to know what is the other component, we just take what is left. So we can take the ij and we subtract from a diagonal matrix the component chi a, kj, tilde, tilde, which is our guy of before. And then we apply to a vector as we did before. We apply to a vector. Now, scalar product, this is for a fixed e, and j is the dummy index that is running for the scalar product. But now what we have? Delta ij times kj, there is the Kronecker delta working with this j, and we get a ke. Then we have kij applied to kj, which is that, and that is equal to ke. Therefore, this guy here is equal to minus KE. That's equal to zero. But we define this guy as the other projector pi orthogonal components AJ. You see? Just a very simple consideration. Just knowing what this is meaning. Here I'm checking what this object is doing once it's applied to a vector. And this object is giving us actually the component of the vector k along the direction E. So E fixes the direction along which you are computing the projection. Okay? Scalar product, we get this part. Then we're asking, what is left out of a diagonal matrix? Well, that's this guy. What's happening when we apply to K? We obtain the other component, which is orthogonal to the previous one. Okay? So this gives us our projection. Now what we can do, this was just mathematics, okay? So this box here, there is no physics, it's just scalar products, okay? And the definition of these projectors. The physics is up here. You understood what is the meaning of A, gives you how the electric field is magnified or how it gets larger or smaller without changing direction. These other terms tells you how the electric field is changing direction. Then, separate concept, we can decompose the vector in terms of components, right? And these components, we defined those components in terms of these projectors that are going to give us the component of epsilon along the direction of K, which must be the direction along which an electromagnetic wave is propagating, and the component which is orthogonal to it. Now that we have these two concepts, we can put them together, because epsilon is epsilon, therefore we can ij, I forgot ij, because ij, therefore this is the component ij of the tensor as well. We can put the two together, therefore these two guys must be equal to each other. And this allows us to express A and B in terms of the projections. Here, just apply the strict equality, and what you end up with is that the fact that A is equal to, actually, the components of the electric field orthogonal to the direction of propagation of the electromagnetic wave, and B, the Fourier transform of B, is equal to the parallel component of the electric field minus the component of the dielectric tensor orthogonal to the propagation of the electric field. So these projectors can tell you how the electric field can be expanded or contracted in terms of its modulus and how it's going to change the direction. And you see how this is strictly related to the direction of the incoming, of the direction of propagation of the incoming electromagnetic wave. Summary, and then little break. What we have seen? Well, we have seen quite a lot. So you have seen how, starting from studying at the displacement of the charges in a local volume, how the dielectric components that are associated to the electric dipoles that are associated to the particles can be put together to, let's say, the contribution can be summed up together to create a macroscopic quantity, which is the macroscopic polarization P. And you understood why we can define the polarization P such that its gradient is equal to the charge density that is created by the displacement of these dipoles, by the presence of these electric dipoles. Okay? And you see how we basically can express this gradient allow us, and this P allow us to express the box, yellow box on the right, the superposition of the dipoles, which gradient, the round box on the left, the yellow round box parenthesis on the left, can give us the density. Okay, that's the concept. It expresses the superposition principle of these dielectric dipoles, of these electric dipoles. Then this charge, raw polarization, must obey charge conservation. This gives us the current associated to this to the raw polarization. Then now that we have the source terms, the density and the charge density and the charge current that are associated to this local polarization, now we can associate to an ensemble properties, can give us a modification to Gauss law. and therefore we can also define the displacement field D, and how Ampere's law is modified by introducing the current J. Then what we did, we just assumed that our plasma is neutral, which is a very fair assumption because usually we deal with ionization effects in astrophysics. And again, I remind you that from the start we assumed that the polarization, the magnetic momentum of the particle is equal to zero, so there is no torque felt by the particle once there is an external magnetic field. And we got our Maxwell's equation in presence of a plasma. Okay? Again, the concept is here, polarization and charge conservation for the charge density associated to the polarization. Then we've seen the importance of the displacement field D that we know to be related to the electric tensor in a linear fashion through the dielectric tensor epsilon. And therefore, we need now to study the electric tensor, because its nature, how it is behaving, depends on the displacement of the particles, and therefore on the very nature and structure of the plasma. So we are digging in now. Going to the fact that the electric tensor must be expressed in terms of the superposition of all the electric fields that are happening around it, taking care about the retardation of the propagation of this electric field. That's why there is a prime as well on the position and on the times here. Going to the Fourier space, we can transform, express this convolution that gives you the sum of all these superposition of the electric field in terms of a product. Okay, in the Fourier space, the convolution is just a product. And we get this expression. Okay, so this expression in Fourier space tells you that the dielectric tensor is given by the superposition of this electric field given some weighting function that takes care to weight the external electromagnetic field in a proper way such that you have the dielectric tensor. Okay? That's the meaning of this equation. Then, we want to dig in, so therefore we want to study this epsilon, and we made this kind of two decompositions. The first one, we look at the component that is responsible for the making the electric field E larger or smaller without changing direction. And the other one, in which we want to see how the epsilon is changing the direction of the electric field. Okay? Then we have another way also thinking about the dielectric tensor, which is by making a decomposition with respect to the direction of an incoming electromagnetic wave. So we have an electromagnetic wave through our plasma going this direction. We have the electric tensor that for some reason is pointing in some direction, given the nature of the plasma. We want to see what is the component of the electric tensor in this component and this component. That's what these projectors are doing. And here I gave you the mathematics, why they look like that. Okay? Some more steps are also present, other considerations are present in the lectures, but I want you to keep in mind that these are just projections of the electric field in those two components given an incoming electromagnetic wave. Given that, we have these two expressions, we can combine them together, and we now have the relationship between the change, the isotropic change of the electric field, which is given by this epsilon orthogonal, and the change of the direction of our electric field, which is given by the difference between these two components. Okay? Good. So we can have a break here, and we can